Even if it's not likely that an HTA will be performed immediately, it's always a good idea actually to prepare at an early stage for an HTA. And so manufacturers have many opportunities to do so. One would be to look at HTAs that exist for the broader clinical discipline, for example, for other comparable technologies that have been evaluated, and for them to understand what were the approaches taken by those entities that have assessed the technology, what kind of evidence were they looking for, what are some of the criticisms that were voiced in these reports, and is there anything that the company can do to proactively prepare for it. Among these opportunities would be, for example, to collect evidence in clinical studies that directly supports previous shortcomings, or to publish information or publish clinical trial findings that then could be used and referred to in future HTAs. There is not a process in place for the manufacturer to initiate or ask for an HTA. Usually it's something that is covered or governed by third parties, by the national healthcare system, for example, by payers, sometimes by providers. There are processes in place where entities can make requests for an HTA, and then the governing body in the respective country or geography actually makes a decision about priorities. And certainly HTAs are always quite an intensive effort and also require resources, so they need to be carefully thinking about which technologies to spend money on in terms of performing a comprehensive HTA. Companies or sponsors, as they're sometimes called, can contribute their internal data and findings. In certain countries and HTA processes, there are specific periods during the review during which manufacturers can actually submit evidence or comment. In other countries, there is not an explicit process to promote or to convey information from the company during the process of the HTA. The analysis is largely out of their control. There is, however, one opportunity, and that is if they do, for example, or perform a cost-effectiveness assessment early on that is published in a peer-reviewed journal, then this evidence is automatically incorporated in the review process. And so there's opportunities to proactively preempt some of the interpretation of the findings by performing high quality studies that are peer reviewed and published that then need to be taken into account. The primary aspects that are studied in HTAs are first the clinical effectiveness, and then as an add-on in some countries, the cost effectiveness piece of the evaluation. Safety is evaluated usually when it comes to procedures that don't necessarily involve devices that are already approved. In the case of pure device HTAs, usually it's a given that the regulatory approval process has taken care of the safety aspects already. When we look at the methods of health technology assessment, usually they comprise first a systematic review of the existing evidence. That means careful literature reviews globally, actually, of findings that are relevant, and then the grading of the evidence. It's patient-relevant endpoints that matter most to HTA entities and to government decision makers. So the question, how does a new technology change morbidity? How is mortality affected? I.e., are there larger survival benefits that should be noted or taken into account? And then definitely patient-related or health-related quality of life in patients. So is there a significant improvement that the patient feels subjectively that should be noted? Once it is completed, there's usually a review process. In a number of cases, there is an opportunity to weigh in by the various stakeholders, be it physician societies or the manufacturers, before a final report is actually made available to the public.